All right, so hello everyone and welcome to our 8th annual GillingsX event. My name is Rohini Rajgopal and I am a second year MSPH MBA student in the HPM department, and I, along with Aditi Kama, serve as the co-chairs for the Student Global Health Committee. Today, we kick off our final session for GillingsX, Resilience in Times of Crises. Our two speakers today will discuss their previous work and research and tie into the theme, growth during a pandemic. Each speaker will give a 10 to 15 minute talk on their work, and we will have time for a short Q&A session after each talk. Please feel free to write any questions you might have or comments into the chat throughout the talks, and we will gladly ask them to our wonderful speakers at the end. Before we begin, the Student Global Health Committee would like to take a moment to acknowledge the horrific events of last week in Atlanta, where eight people lost their lives and many more were wounded in what should be described as nothing short of a hate crime. We also want to acknowledge the rise in anti-Asian sentiment, as well as the continual prejudice and racism felt by BIPOC individuals, both domestic and abroad. It needs to end. Secondly, we recognize that the University of North Carolina sits on the land of Native American tribes. Just as in global health, we recognize historical colonization abroad, we also recognize the past and ongoing impacts of colonization of Native American lands here in North Carolina. Lastly, before we begin, we want to give a huge thank you to all of the Student Global Health Committee members for making this event possible, to Dean Reimer for her continuous support of GillingsX and the Student Global Health Committee, and to our wonderful advisor, Naya Villarreal. First up, we have Kate Edwards, an MPH candidate in applied epidemiology, pronouns she, her, hers. Kate works as a research specialist with Dr. Ralph Barrick and says of her GillingsX talk, "Working as a coronavirologist in emerging infectious diseases has always been exciting, but many outside the field did not see the relevance until the pandemic hit." She will focus on what working to fight a pandemic on the research / science side of things has been like, which often gets overlooked. The floor is yours, Kate.
Thank you. Okay, can everyone actually see your presentation and not speaker slides? Good?
Yep, you're okay. Good.
Cool. So I'm gonna be talking about the role of research in pandemic preparedness and response, specifically because science and public health are often presented as two distinct disciplines, but really the two coexist in such a way that one really can't thrive without the other. So I'm gonna open with, what do we really mean when we say new and emerging viruses? So new viruses are really only new in the sense that they're not known to have previously infected or caused disease in humans. It doesn't mean that they just kind of magically popped out of thin air. This is particularly true with coronaviruses, specifically with COVID, because we often hear the coronavirus when we're talking about COVID in the public, in the media, because it's kind of the first time people have really heard about coronaviruses. But really, SARS-CoV-2 is just a new coronavirus, but the public doesn't realize that it's actually seen them before. So we're going to take you on a little bit of a journey through the fact that these viruses have actually been around for hundreds and hundreds of years. So in these first three viruses we've got here, these are actually the common cold viruses. So we've all seen these countless times. We got them as kids, we get them as adults, we get the sniffles, it goes away. But what I really want to focus on is these four viruses at the bottom, which is actually where we're seeing this accelerating cross-species movement. So in the last two decades, we've seen a SARS outbreak, a MERS outbreak, and we're obviously all very familiar with the SARS-CoV-2 outbreak. So why is this happening? This is happening and is likely to keep happening as humans expand into habitats that were previously inhabited solely by animals. So as humans come in more contact with animals than we ever used to be, the interaction between them is increasing. So different things are able to be swapped, including viruses. So when we talk about coronavirus research, often me and most of my colleagues, it's a lot of, why do you study coronaviruses? Why don't you study flu or Ebola or something that seems more relevant? Obviously pre-pandemic. So this graph is basically just the number of completed peer-reviewed published studies that come out online that are studies that have been finished, done, the results are posted. So we see the steady but gradual increase in publications from the early 1950s until the early 2000s, and then SARS hits. So when SARS hits, we see this minor jump, which levels out honestly through MERS emergence in 2011. And this goes on until about 2019. And then we all know what happens next, COVID hits. So when COVID hit, we see this massive, massive jump in interest in the field. People are racing to get things done. In 2019, there were a little less than 900 publications. And in the past year, there were around 68,000. So what does this 68,000 represent? This represents the resilience journey of scientists in the past year. It represents the answer to why do you study coronaviruses? It's our role in getting the country back on track to normal. It's informing frontline workers, healthcare workers, public health officials. It's countless hours in the lab, many of which are in high containment. It's what we've been doing and our responsibility to kind of fight this pandemic and get us all back to where we want to be. So in a more practical sense, what does the 68,000 publications really mean? So other than the obvious massive ramp up in basic coronavirus research, it's how we understand what cell types are infected in humans. It's how we study and predict potential hosts, both pre and post human emergence. It's how we develop and study therapeutics such as antibody treatments and antivirals, which we terms that we see floating around the media. And the big one that everyone's really excited about, it's how we test and develop new vaccine candidates. So I'm going to focus a little bit on this bench to bedside approach. This is a very complicated schematic. Don't worry too much about the nitty gritty details. I basically want to focus over here in this green square, which basically says that basic testing has to happen before clinical studies can happen. So basically it's this basic research where we screen different candidates. We test in vitro, which just means in cells in a plate. Medicinal chemistry happens, is how we're able to determine what kinds of drugs and compounds may work well in a human before we can even get over here to all this phase one, phase two clinical stuff. One of the really big ones that's huge right now is remdesivir, which was the drug that Trump was given, that lots of other people have been given, that's been seen in the news all the time. And the nice thing about remdesivir is that it was actually previously studied for use in MERS and then was emergency use authorized by the FDA for use in the Ebola outbreak, and now it's being used for SARS-2. So for just kind of what the lab in general has been doing, this is obviously a very long list of different therapeutics and vaccines, but want to draw your attention to the ones that you guys are probably familiar with. So remdesivir, Eli Lilly antibodies, Moderna, and Johnson & Johnson vaccines are all things that the lab's been involved in. So how do we actually study these? How do we get to study antivirals and vaccines? So one of the primary ways that we do this is through primary human cells. So these cells are going to come out of the respiratory tract, given that coronaviruses are often respiratory viruses. This is where we focus. So these are human airway epithelial cells. So the two main cell types here are these goblet cells, which are actually the ones that produce the mucus. And then we have these ciliated cells, which have these little finger-like projections that actually come in contact with everything that you breathe in, including virus particles. So these are just multi-layers of cells that allow us to study the detailed impacts of coronaviruses on the human airway without actually having to be in someone's throat. And then really quickly, this is just what it would look like under a microscope if someone were to put a microscope in your throat, basically. So how are we actually able to use these cells to see anything? There's a few ways that we can visualize infected cells. So one of the main ways is through reporter viruses, which actually can be generated to have a fluorescent protein, which will allow us to see infected cells in real time. So all of these green cells here are actually cells that have been infected with SARS-CoV-2. So these are examples of those primary cells and allows us to look at a cell culture while we're actively doing an experiment and say, is the cell getting infected or not? Another way we can do that is through microscopy. So light microscopy allows us to make these really cool stained pictures. You can basically fix a culture and then stain it with a bunch of different antibodies, and everything again here in green is an infected cell. And we can go a little bit deeper at a higher resolution and stain for certain markers and scan the surface of the culture using electron microscopy. And that's how we get these really detailed pictures. So all of these little blue tube looking things are actually the cilia I talked about previously. And all of these red dots are actually virus particles. So we're able to visualize the fact that, okay, so ciliated cells are the cells that are getting infected most frequently with these viruses. So what kinds of therapeutics can we do that will target these cells to hopefully reduce the amount of infection in a human? So for example, with remdesivir, just look down here at this pink box, ignore everything up here. Basically what this is saying is that as we increase the amount, we increase the dose of remdesivir, the number of little pink dots, which is actually MERS coronavirus, goes away. So as we reach this maximum dose, we have just about no virus here infecting any cells versus the untreated, which has a lot. So now what? So now we have therapeutics. This is all fantastic. But what about vaccines? Everyone wants to know about vaccines. And more importantly, everybody wants to know how we were able to generate a coronavirus vaccine so quickly while still being safe. And we were able to do that because here is the entire vaccine pipeline. And basic research still fits over here in the beginning with preclinical testing. But while the normal pipeline takes about 5 to 10 years for basic research, and it's a whole 15 to 20 year process, down here with SARS-CoV-2, it happened in about 10 months. And it happened in about 10 months because of this box right here. We were able to use information from other related viruses. So more specifically for the SARS-CoV-2 vaccine process, over here in this gray box is just different titles of three papers where we were focusing on the mRNA vaccine originally used for the MERS virus. And that's how we were able to take this technology and basically tweak it and re-engineer it for SARS-CoV-2. So all of the base work had already happened. All of the nitty-gritty details had already happened. So in 2019, in December, when the first outbreak happened in China, just 2 weeks later, the sequences of the viruses were published. And then literally 3 days later, the VRC and the NIH, who worked with Moderna on the Moderna vaccine, had already decided on what the vaccine sequences should be because we already had this information. So one day after that, mass production started and they were able to start mass production before clinical trials. And it was definitely a risky thing in the sense that, you know, we didn't know whether this was gonna work, but everything kind of happened simultaneously instead of consecutively because we were prepared to do this. So shortly after that, small animal models were vaccinated. The FDA says, okay, we're safe to proceed. My lab received mice for studying and then clinical trials started in March. The second round started in May and the last round started in July. And clinical trials are just, I know everyone hears that word a lot, but for people that aren't familiar, phase one is just a really small group of healthy individuals. Phase two is in a larger group of individuals, and phase three is when it goes into larger populations. So here we are now in March of 2021, and we are quickly approaching the world being vaccinated. So here we're talking just about this mRNA vaccine design that was enabled by pathogen preparedness. But the real thing I want to get to about here is that because of all these pandemic preparedness efforts, we were able to get to this goal of within 58 new days of the administration, we've had 100 million shots in people's arms, which is a really massive accomplishment and puts us much closer to actually getting back to normal and fighting this pandemic. So the next question is, now that we've talked about preparing and responding to this pandemic, what happens after COVID? Because if you remember back to one of my first slides, these viruses have been around forever and ever, and they're going to continue to be around forever and ever. Unfortunately, this will not be the last pandemic that the world sees. So all these emerging viruses that we talked about before, we don't always know when they're coming. So with SARS-CoV-2, we didn't know it was here until it was here. But sometimes we get a little bit of a heads up. So I want to put your focus down here in this little box, which is SARS-CoV, which is swine acute diarrheal virus, which is a virus that outbroke in China. It's only infecting pigs right now, but that doesn't mean that it's not an emerging coronavirus. So what I was able to do is determine the infected host range of this virus. So these are the same fluorescent cells that I was talking about before. It's just that this one's red instead of green. So obviously we already know that it infects pig cells, but we were also able to determine that it infects cat and monkey cells, but also different types of human cells. So these are just those primary cells I had said before. So when this information came out in the media, the primary question was, oh no, is this the next pandemic? Should we all panic? So on and so forth. This right here does not by any means mean that this virus is going to outbreak in humans. All it means is that these emerging viruses are continuing to emerge and we can use basic research to study these viruses prior to human impact to potentially determine the type of impact that may happen. So why does that matter? It matters because it helps us be prepared but remain unpanicked. So it's impossible to predict if this virus or any other virus could emerge and infect human populations. But because we know this virus exists in the swine population or any other virus that we know exists in an animal population, and we know that humans are often coming in contact with these animals, we can conduct necessary surveillance and prepare for the possibility of a spillover. So in the way that the CDC talks about it in this schematic is that as we increase testing and monitoring to detect illness in animals and people, we can provide guidance to farms, factory workers, open markets overseas, to increase the standards and surveillance that they have, both for themselves and for animals, to determine if anything weird is popping up. And this is how we can help prevent this as an influenza pandemic, but really any zoonotic pandemic that could come off, such as SARS-CoV-2. So just to kind of wrap this back around too, I talked a little bit in the beginning about what it's been like for researchers in general, but kind of just to put into perspective what the last year has been like for me in the lab. Since the pandemic started, I have run approximately 10,000 HAE cultures. I've completed 90 multi-day experiments that usually last about a week, and I've spent approximately 1,000 hours in the BSL-3, which is our high containment facility for virus work. And for those of you that aren't familiar with what being in a high containment facility is like, we look like this. So basically we have to wear these massive PAPRs and suits and gowns so that we can breathe filtered air so that we can work with these respiratory viruses without infecting ourselves or potentially spreading it to anybody else. I just wanted to end with this quote that says, no matter how much falls on us, we keep plowing ahead, and that's the only way to keep the roads clear, which I think is a really good way to kind of wrap up the role that scientists have played in the fact that no matter how many viruses pop up or what happens or different variants or anything like that, all we can really do is keep working and pushing ahead. So this is just my acknowledgments. There's lots and lots of people in all these labs. I just wanted to highlight the people that have specifically been involved in my work. And that's it.
Thank you, Kate, for all your contributions to coronavirus research and for sharing some of this virology foundation with us. It was super interesting to learn. We will now open up the floor for questions. Feel free to unmute yourselves or just type the questions in the chat. And we will have a couple of minutes. Thank you.
I have a question. Thank you for that presentation. It was really, really interesting. You were talking about how this will not be the last pandemic in our lifetimes and won't be the last pandemic for like people who live on Earth in general. I was wondering if you knew anything about, I mean, this is just something I've heard about, like viruses potentially coming out of the permafrost as ice caps are melting and as global climate change gets worse and worse. I don't know if that's legitimate or if we do, we should be worrying about, I don't know, new viruses coming up as a result of climate change, or if you had any information about that.
So in regards to climate change, so I'm not super familiar with how likely the permafrost thing is. I guess like similarly to how we actually store all of our virus stocks at minus 80, if something were preserved in the way, or the RNA was preserved in such a way that it actually maintained intact and viable, I guess it's possible. But the climate change thing also has to do with the fact that as the temperatures are constantly warming and changing, it's changing these environments for these animals that are potentially infected with these different viruses that we haven't seen yet. So it also brings them closer to us and just kind of changes the entire dynamic of how different species interact. And it's really the species interaction that's causing a lot of this zoonotic crossover between humans and animals, or from humans even to other species, because sometimes it can also go in the opposite direction.
Got it. Thank you.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Hi. Thank you for your work. I am aware that in Germany, there was a lot of public engagement from experts in virology and epidemiology that served to educate the population. What kind of efforts are you seeing or are you a part of in the United States? Or is there even a drive to educate the population with information like you are presenting tonight?
So I will definitely say that the effort that there is, I don't personally think there's enough of it. I think that, kind of like I said in the beginning, science and public health tend to be these distinct disciplines when really they're not. One really can't exist without the other. I think that a lot of the climate and the way that information gets disseminated and the way that people interpret this information has a lot to do with people's backgrounds. It has a lot to do with people's cultures. It has a lot to do with the political climate. And in this country, obviously that varies significantly by location, person, and so forth. So I do think that there could be a bigger effort for sure for things like this, as opposed to just really strict public health talks or really strict science talks, because it kind of shows that there is a connection between the two. So I guess the short answer is that there definitely could be better initiatives to do it. I haven't personally been involved in them just because I've been strictly on the science side of things until I started this program. But I know some of my coworkers have been able to give some of those talks.
Kate, I have a question.
Yeah.
Thank you for that wonderful presentation. What was it like working in the Barrick lab? Like, what was it like being in an environment that was such a, like, internationally now famous lab? And, like, what was the morale like throughout the process? And
yeah.
Could you give us a little, like, insider insight?
Yeah, so we actually kept pretty good morale, honestly. We're all pretty close and friendly. It's a really big lab. There's, like, 30 plus of us. But it was actually really nice that, you know, as soon as Ralph was like, okay, the virus coming out of China is a coronavirus, we kind of all knew that, okay, this was it. Like, we're all about to be working 60 plus hours a week. We're not going to be getting much sleep. We're going to be spending lots of hours in high containment. And that's what we did. We, you know, worked in shifts. We worked really around the clock, and we're definitely working less around the clock now, but we are all still very all hands on deck, you know, just kind of pushing through. But I think we all focused on the fact that this is kind of our, I guess, biggest chance to demonstrate that science plays a really big role in public health. There was a much more immediate human impact with what we were doing, instead of just, you know, making these publications and having them go float around PubMed, no one ever reads them. So I think that's really what kept us going.
Kate, you have a question in the chat. Thanks for sharing your work. Do you have any thoughts on how prepared scientists are to respond to the COVID variant strains, such as by developing booster vaccines?
Yeah, so one of the nice things about some of the assays that we can run is that we can actually collect samples from vaccinated patients and basically spin down those samples to take their antibodies and test them against these different variant strains to figure out how well they are, how effective they remain compared to the original strain. But the nice thing about the mRNA vaccine and the technology is that it's very plastic. So while 10 months is crazy speed to be able to develop a vaccine, if we were to come across a variant that just completely escaped antibody treatment, so it was completely ineffective against, or rephrase that, the vaccine is completely ineffective against the variant, it would only be a pretty short process in order to actually develop a booster vaccine to make it more effective. That would mean that everybody that was vaccinated would need to get a booster. But at this point, thankfully, it seems like none of the variants have really been different enough that they're escaping immunity, but we are definitely working on things like that and constantly screening variants and keeping our eyes peeled for anything that could point to the fact that we would definitely need to develop any sorts of booster shots.
And I think we could do one last question. So another question from the chat, how many spillovers happen that the public doesn't put any weight in? Is there certain ones we should be aware of?
So most big spillovers that would happen that would, so, okay. So with COVID, we still don't really know where the spillover came from, right? We know that there's related bat viruses in China, but we don't know what the intermediate host was. Most big spillovers the public would be aware of because people would start getting sick. But other than that, I would really hope that public health wasn't trying to cover up any sort of spillovers that would happen. But the only big emerging coronavirus that I'm aware of right now is the SARS virus that I talked about, which at this point has only infected pigs, thankfully. But that allows us to survey lots of the swine workers in China and survey the swine populations in other countries to determine whether there is a potential for any spillover to occur.
All right, thank you so much, Kate. Really, really enjoyed your talk. And if you have any more questions for Kate, feel free to hold on to them until the end and we'll see if we have some time to get to that. But last but not least, our final speaker is Dr. Bobby Banks. Pronouns she, her, hers, an adjunct assistant professor at Gillings in the Public Health Leadership Program and CEO of Pillar Consulting, a global research and evaluation consulting firm headquartered here in Durham, North Carolina. Dr. Banks' training in epidemiology and health behavior has led her to create a digital and print COVID-19 prevention campaign rooted in equity. This grassroots campaign, Not a Host, has garnered support locally and nationally thanks to brilliant minds and efforts of a vast network of community advocates, students, and everyday people dedicated to health equity. Dr. Banks says of her GillingsX talk, I spent most of the last year floating between frustration and desperation. COVID-19 brought to light the very inequities we, as public health professionals, work to eliminate every day. I decided to draw on the innovation, expertise, and creativity of colleagues and friends to move Not a Host forward, and I'm forever grateful for their belief in this vision. I'll pass it over to you now, Dr. Banks.
There you go.
Good to go.
All right. Thank you so much. I'm going to go ahead and get this talk started. So I want to tell you about some old friends who dropped in a few months ago. And between you and I was not that excited to see them, particularly in the midst of a global pandemic, a dual pandemic, in fact, where the rest of the world is seeing the manifestations of not only the COVID-19 pandemic, but also deeply rooted systemic and structural racism. It had been about 14 or 15 years since I had seen these friends. And quite frankly, when I bid them adieu, was a very peaceful life. And I felt like I was back to the Bobby that I knew about 20 years prior. But this is what happens in moments of crisis or crises. These folks pop up unannounced, uninvited, unfiltered, unapologetic. In fact, you may know them. Despair, hopelessness, helplessness, anger, depression, confusion, stress. And what we have been taught culturally in the context of resilience is that keep pushing, you're strong. You can do it, keep pressing on. And in fact, when I looked at the definition for resilience, you know, it talked about elasticity or bouncing back, and it was quite often followed with the word quickly. Why? Why in the context of this life for humans do we feel this need to bounce back quickly? And so while some people may take this as a compliment or as a, you know, kind of a charge to move forward in the midst of all of these emotions, I would like to take a moment to think about redefining resilience. And so you might be asking yourself right now, like, well, where did you meet these people, Bobby? I unfortunately lost my mother unexpectedly years and years and years ago. And these folks popped up. I had no familiarity with them. And I did not even know how to own or navigate or walk through them. But it was through some of the things that I'll walk you through that I was able to get on the other side. And so that was a small personal crisis for me. But in the midst of this larger crisis, I drew on some of those same things. And as I was introduced as part of this talk, you'll see what I was able to do as part of redefining this resilience and moving forward and thinking about innovation. So I am a learner of the world. I'm always looking around for lessons in nature, through other people, through children, through experts. What lessons is the world teaching us about who we should be? should we be on this rat race? Should we keep pressing on and pushing on in the midst of trauma, despair, death? And so thinking about all of the other responsibilities we had in the midst of this pandemic, and also learning how to be scientists, as Caitlin has pointed out, and translating some of this information into everyday language, I had to learn to reset and to redo my math. What does that mean? The picture on the left is Jackie Robinson. And I have an excellent mentor that told me, as part of my frustration of still wanting to produce, he said, "Hey, Bobby, you can make it into the Hall of Fame batting 3 out of 10. And I thought, okay. Let me think through some realistic expectations and extend myself some grace. And so that's my ownership and my bigger piece of it. But what about friends, family, employers, bosses, industries? What are the expectations in terms of the health and resilience of your staff, family members, leaders, employees, direct reports in the midst of a double pandemic? My recommendation and the grace that I was extended that helped me thrive in my personal crisis was extending grace and redoing the math. The second thing that I love, I'm very clumsy, and one of the things I trip over more often than not are tree roots. That is my life. I stay in physical therapy. But one thing that I love about tree roots is that they are going to thrive, period. And I love this picture because this tree figured out how it was going to continue its journey and how it was going to continue to grow. And so anytime I'm in nature and I see roots cracking through concrete before I trip on them, I think about, wow, what power. And it brought me to a higher level of thinking of, well, in this whole journey, people have a sentiment that they have to survive. You know, I'm here surviving. I'm doing the best I can with the circumstances I have. And I fully acknowledge that we cannot control everything in this world. I also think that we have access and hopefully have access to resources that can help us navigate some of the trouble in our journeys. And so I say jokingly to people, like, we're not on a reality show. You have more than a machete and, you know, a little Vaseline to work out your life. Let's think about redefining that and thinking about what it means to thrive in this lifetime. And that's what I think about when I see trees disrupting structures or bursting through with their roots, right? And so this is progress towards a goal to grow or develop vigorously. How does this play out in real life in the midst of a double pandemic? Because last year was very difficult for a lot of people, myself included. And so I had to go back to my roots, all puns intended, and think about what I was taught and how to navigate some of these struggles. I'm going to share them with you and show how I turn this frustration, this desperation, this hopelessness into a beautiful campaign, thanks to the brilliant minds of people who I know and don't know as part of my defining resilience. So a lot of people know me as Dorothy's Child. This is me pinning my mother during her nursing ceremony. And that is her. She was an excellent and amazing nurse who always served people. And she used to say to me, "I'm a 4-H girl, we make the best better." And as a military child, we lived in a lot of different places and places we did and did not want to be. And we learned how to thrive, how to be good citizens and servants wherever we were. And so I leaned into her and thought about some of the creative things that I used to do as a child and how I can move that forward as part of my work. And so resilience causes, or in my opinion, resilience requires you to be still, to rest, to breathe, so that you can recenter and restore yourself if you have that luxury. If you are a boss or a family member or someone else who can afford the opportunities for people to restore, offering that opportunity. For me, my preemptive steps are flowers. I love flowers. I love yellow flowers, tulips, sunflowers. And so when this pandemic was coming down the pike early spring and I knew that Dorothy's Child had to be in the house, I tried to make the space as conducive for good spirits as I could, because I knew that this was going to be a tough journey. And this was before we saw the police brutality coming down the pike much, much later. And now at the beginning of this talk, we know about Asian American violence as well, or violence against Asian Americans, I should say. And so part of my restoration during this pandemic was, girl, get you some flowers, put a little sunshine in your house for yourself. The second thing that I love doing is creating. I've doodled my entire life. If you were ever in class with me, I was probably doing a word cross or who knows, whatever. During this crisis, I thought about exactly what Kate and Caitlin brought to light. And I don't know if they'll publish these one before the other, but what she brought to light was two distinct kind of areas, science and public health. How do we translate this to everyday people? What better way than to pull into my experience as a public health professional and contribute what I could as I was resting? And so I started doodling with better technology now and thought, hey, let's make this fun and tell people what they can do and put animation and strike through everything here. Just don't do it. Don't do it until we're out of the pandemic. And then I thought, hey, I think we can do a play on the word host. As a biology major, who took courses in immunology, microbiology, I fully understood what host meant in the biological sense. And I thought it would be a great play on do everything within your power that you can to not become a host. And also think about it socially. And I'll walk you through what that looked like. So I started creating at home, doodling on paper and thinking about the two different ways that you can be a host. And then I started reaching out to colleagues, our networks, our support systems, the same people I called and said, horrible day, I know I'm supposed to get sunshine, but I'd rather eat ice cream. Same people, hey, I have an idea. Let me share this with you. Tell me what you think. And so that grew into this full out campaign that was part of this introduction I shared with you. Part of my recentering, part of my restoration, part of my rest and part of my resilience in this journey and redefining it for myself was making sure that I was mentally well, emotionally well, and I'm trying physically well, but goodness gracious, whew, food, yes. And so I wanted to create something that allowed that balance and that would also serve as a connection for people to engage in a culturally relevant way. And so I'll share the website with you at the end, but just to introduce you very, very briefly to this, we wanted to make something culturally engaging, right? And so there are ways that we engage with one another, particularly thinking about the communities that were most disproportionately impacted by COVID-19. That was another huge pain point. Black and brown people were being hospitalized, dying, and getting COVID at disproportionate rates compared to their white counterparts. So how can we start thinking about how to support other institutions and how can we create something innovative? I'll show you what we did. So the first thing was that distinction between host. Hey, if you're the person sending out the text, hey, got a barbecue, bring the drinks, bring the ice, you're hosting an event. But we're in the midst of a global pandemic, so if you can hold off, please do that. The other opportunity was anchoring back on biological sciences. This is the host you might not know. You could have this virus in your body. You might have symptoms, you might not. And so this is an opportunity for us to engage with people in a different way and connect this not only in a digital means. We were able to create Facebook frames and thinking about the digital space because we use this to raise awareness with so many other things, domestic violence, breast cancer, all of these other things. And also print, because what we also know, we have those disproportionate outcomes because of racism and structures and systems, and also because of the places that people live. They may not have access because of racist policy and regulations that predate all of us. And if they don't have access to simple things like Wi-Fi, preventive care, hospitals, then how will they get the information? So we thought we could support in small or big way by offering print materials as well. And so I'll give you one quick example. When I say culturally relevant, what does that mean? This is the greatest, Muhammad Ali. Much of my childhood was watching documentaries with my father, who I thought was Muhammad Ali as well. But one thing that we saw, and even talking to everyday people, was the asymptomatic piece wasn't quite clear. And so we thought about this and kind of, you know, pre-tested or with other people and said, hey, does this make sense to you? Your immune system is like Muhammad Ali. You're fighting every day, all day. You may not even know, but you will know when you get a symptom. And so we know allergy season's coming up. If you sneeze, cough, drizzle, eye rash, whatever you have, that is a symptom, an immune response that produces a symptom that you feel or see. So what scientists are telling you is that you might have none of that, and you could still have coronavirus. And so this is an opportunity for us to create. this is a very smart, very small part of the campaign, and I know we are limited by time, but what I wanted to share with you is that there is hope. That, in fact, I firmly believe that we are the people that we have been waiting for. I think that we have much that we can redefine for ourselves, including resilience. And I charge and I challenge not only individuals to think through their mental, emotional, spiritual, physical health, but also the places that hire, the places that support, the places that nurture individuals and communities that have been historically marginalized. So I challenge you to be the change you have been waiting for. And thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Banks. Like before, we will open up the floor to questions, and please feel free to ask away.
Dr. Banks, do you have any thoughts about employers starting to take seriously the needs of people to recover and take the time that you talk about? I think a lot of employers, myself working as an ICU nurse, we are used to going in when we're sick unless we're literally dying and putting others' people's needs before ourselves. And many, I think, women do this particularly, but I think it's because of the pull also of our culture in the United States. We don't take vacations. We work more than every other country. Do you have any ideas about how we can get buy-in from employers and, you know, speak to their productivity needs? Or do you see any trends nationally regarding this?
I will say that is not my area of expertise in terms of data or knowing the data that supports that shift and that the need for that shift. But I do know the power of data. And as you said, we are the society that culturally will work ourselves until we can't work anymore. And so what we know with so many other programs, abstinence only, childhood education, that we have seen that what we're doing may not be the best, and we present that data. So we have to think about the leaders that we need at the top, that we need to think about the people who need a seat at the table and perhaps who needs to give up their seat at the table so that we can have these culture shifts, right? And so the reason I know that I needed rest was because I had an excellent boss who saw me after my grief with my mother, and she saw me trying to continue pushing through. That's all I knew. And she had me close the door in her office, and she asked me one question: how are you doing? No one else had asked me that. No one else. And that's when I lost it. She gave me the freedom and space for that. She gave me time off. And she also was the one that told me, hey, everybody needs a paid friend. I don't know about therapy. I had no idea about it. And so I think that at a policy level, it's going to be a reflection of having the right person in the right seat and some sort of paradigm shift with data that people really use to inform program and policy. From a public health perspective, we know how difficult that is because we still have abstinence-only education and we know it does not work. And so many others, right? And so even producing the data from saying, you know, European nations or South American nations, and look, more productive citizens, 5-day work weeks, healthcare covers everyone, comorbidities are exponentially lower. We don't know that the people at the table will take that data and do the right information with it. And I talk to my students about this every week. Like, this is why we need you to have a seat at the table. I hope that answered your question, but I don't want to pretend I'm an expert in that way.
No, it sounds right. And that's what we need to do. Get a seat at the table, just like you said, access equals opportunity.
Thank you. And I will say the people that afforded me, I have clients from all over, and I will say the people that afforded me an opportunity to breathe during this pandemic, particularly after George Floyd and Breonna Taylor were murdered, were, and I know the data does support this, but they were my female clients that gave me time, that I had extensions on deadlines, that our meetings were about non-work related information for weeks, right? And so again, that goes to culture and leadership. So even with what I needed during the pandemic in the space where I was creating, I had some clients that, actually they're psychologists, that's probably why, clients who afforded that space, gave the time, asked how you were doing, allowed you to speak about it. And I had some that were, hey, are we ready for Friday at 10 o'clock? So that's why I know it's a ref- and that's why I think it is a reflection of the leadership.
Dr. Banks, you have a question in the chat. How can we support your movement and amplify your efforts?
Yeah, this was an hour. This was an hour long. I could have given you the whole shebang, but what's crazy is, clearly as you saw through this, as quickly as I could say it, I did this because it's a passion, translating information. And so when we started sharing this with people, they said, well, how can we donate? I'm like, donate what, time? So in terms of supporting us, you can go to the website and see the different ways that you can engage with us. We got support from actually Facebook to help us with the digital work and also the Maya Angelou Center for Health Equity Research. And so if people would like to support in that way, that'd be great. Or if you want to be an ambassador and a voice, as I said, we are the people we've been waiting for. And so if you work at a place that is disadvantaged or marginalized or historically oppressed, and these are resources that would be helpful, let us know. We're now working with systems. I don't know if I can say it, but we'll be working with systems across the state of North Carolina very, very soon and possibly across the country, because people spoke about this work at the table and we're excited about it. So if there are opportunities where, again, seats at tables, if there are opportunities for us to engage with other partners, community-based organizations, academic institutions, nonprofit organizations, our job is to serve and support them. But you can go to notahost.com and all that information is there. And you can be a voice on the campaign. We don't have enough time, but you can lend your voice and give your why. So that's another thing we know with behavioral theory. And I didn't get into all of that either, but we kind of know we follow the crowd in many ways. And so we wanted to create material that reflected peer norms or normative beliefs, right? And so people are sharing their whys. So why are you engaging in the preventive behaviors you should during a global pandemic? And so their people's whys range from, I'm waiting for my girls' trip next year, we gotta go, believe it, to I'm tired of dressing up just to go to the kitchen from the living room. I miss hugging my friends and loved ones. I'm tired of doing the elbow. And so these are things that we'll be pushing. You'll see us on social media and on the internet over the next few months. So engage, share, support. This is public health.
I have a question, Dr. Banks. Mm-hmm. I really appreciate how you touched on your need to kind of take a step back and take that time for yourself, especially because even throughout the pandemic, I feel like we've been given this rhetoric, especially like online and on social media, that, oh, you're stuck at home. Here's 20 ideas for how you can redo your house. And for me, that was personally so overwhelming. So hearing about how you were able to create and innovate during such unprecedented times, do you think that taking a step back allowed you to have that space? Because I still don't feel like I'm even thriving. Like, I feel like I'm at the baseline of surviving.
Absolutely. And that's okay. You own that, right? And so I have a diagram where I have two concentric circles, and the big circle is time and the smaller circle is mental capacity. At the beginning of this pandemic, my brain was here, like repeated trauma, death, 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 global pandemic. There is no, your body is not meant to hold these things. Your body needs to release stress, right? The cortisol does not need to just sit in your body. Like, you have to release these stressors, right? And so what I knew I needed was to rest, because trying to push myself, it's like running your car on fumes, right? You're going to be pulled over at the side of the road. And so it was a balance of knowing I needed to be still, to rest. I canceled work for an entire week, and I was very clear when I came back the next week. It was very difficult being in a double pandemic and had to disconnect from the images I was seeing on television. And so that disconnection, that rest got me back to that place. Now, the system's still there, right? The system is still operating. And so that's why there are higher responsibilities, so that this isn't a repeated cycle. And so rest, without question. Thank you for mentioning social media. Our brains are also not meant to do this all day. So rest is important. And doing what works for you. I dance, I sing, I karaoke, I create. That's what I do. For someone else, it might be teaching. For someone else, it might be gardening. I tried, I have 3 plants. One is dead, it's on the floor. I wouldn't even show it to you. That's not my gift, right? And that's another. Everyone's doing gardening right now, and it's beautiful. Grow your own food. You know, have fresh air in your home, but I literally had to Google the plants that required the least amount of attention, and that's what I have. And then I tried to do one that required attention, and I'm not even gonna show you two. It's in bad shape. It's usually up there, but it's in really bad shape. So you have to know what works for you.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Banks. Lovely, lovely talk. And thank you, Kate, as well. We are going to just quickly wrap up. And obviously, if you have any other questions for either of our speakers today, please feel free to stay on for a couple minutes and ask them those questions. But to everyone that's attended so far today or any of the other sessions that we had this week, thank you so much for joining us and hearing from our fantastic speakers on what resilience means to them in times of crises. If you're interested in joining or learning more about the Student Global Health Committee, you can follow us on social media at sghc_UNC or email us at sghc@unc.edu. Thank you all so much for joining. Please stay safe, and we will see you next year at GillingsX 2022.